Children are dismissed to Children's Church. Turn with me to Galatians chapter 3 this morning. Galatians chapter 3. Appreciate the choir's ministry of the word via song to us. Song that will tie in very well with our text and message this morning. So Galatians chapter 3, let's look at verses 1 through 5. Brothers and sisters, this is the word of the Lord. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? Have you experienced so much in vain, if it really was in vain? So again, I ask, does God give you his Spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law or by your believing what you heard? Amen. The word of the Lord. Let's give thanks to God and pray. Father in heaven, thank you again for your word. We love it and we are lost without it. So teach it to us during this time. Give us spiritual understanding, faith, obedience. May we tremble at your word. May we rejoice at the promises. Fill me with your Spirit. Grant that we will see Christ here and love him. We'll grow in our knowledge and our obedience. And just we will, again, rejoice that you're speaking to us. We hear your voice in the scriptures. Open our ears, we pray. Do that for us. Do that for our young people. Thank you for this time we have. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. One of the Bible stories that children tend to know well is the story of the Battle of Jericho. After 40 years of wandering in the wilderness, the new generation of Israelites stands ready to cross the Jordan River and inherit the promised land. But there's just one problem. Jericho, the mighty walled city, stands in their way, and it's shut up day and night where they cannot possibly enter it through the means they have as an army. But if we read through that book and that story, one thing God really makes clear is that he is the one who is going to give them the city. He's the one who's going to give them the whole land. And this first stop gives him the perfect opportunity to display his power and his grace. And so, as you know from the story, instead of giving them a battle plan, some way to sneak into the city, some way to make those walls weak and undermine them, instead, God says you're to march around the city for 7 days. Once a day for the first 6 days, 7 times on the 7th day. And then shout, because the Lord has given you the city. And I don't know about you, but if I was in that army, I think I might have struggled a little bit with those instructions. We're going to march around the city. What is that going to accomplish? But again, God's whole point is to make us realize that he's the one who's going to give them the city. And so from start to finish, the destruction of those walls would take place by God's power and by God's grace. Now here in Galatians 3, Paul is going to make the same point about the Christian life, that it begins and that it ends, or it finishes, by God's grace, by faith, by the work of his Spirit. Past 2 weeks, we looked at the previous verses where Paul outlined the gospel that he preaches, that sinners obtain a right standing with God through faith alone in Christ alone. That the purpose of the law is to condemn us so that we will seek that right standing through faith alone in Christ alone. And then that all of this, that right standing, that forgiveness, and with it power to live for God, it all comes to us by God's grace. It all comes to us because we're united with Christ, both in his death and in his resurrection. That is the gospel. Now, as Paul comes into chapter 3, he's going to deal with this idea. While the gospel may bring us into a right standing with God, and while faith alone may start the Christian life, will it also guarantee our acceptance on the final day?
if you've confessed your faith in Jesus Christ, is that enough to guarantee that on the last day, God is going to declare that you are part of his people? That he's going to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Come inherit this heavenly kingdom. Well, these Judaizers, these false teachers, this is where they've come in and run their interference. And they have told the Galatians that while faith might be how you start the Christian journey, that is not enough to finish it. It is necessary that you obey the Mosaic law, receive circumcision, obey the dietary rules and these other ceremonial laws. You have to have those marks in order for God to recognize on the last day that you are part of his people. If you hope to hear God say, well done, you have to do these things. And as we come to chapter 3, Paul is now ready to challenge that head on. He's laid the groundwork, and now he's going to challenge what they are saying and prove the truth of his gospel. And here's where he's going to appeal in the verses we look at today, to the work of the Spirit. The work of the Spirit among the Galatians shows them that faith in Christ is not only sufficient to begin the Christian life, but to finish it as well. That we begin and we finish the Christian life the same way, through faith in Christ and the work of the Spirit. Now, as we say that, that language, it might be a little confusing. Okay, what do you mean I continue the Christian life through faith? I mean, are we saying that I just kind of passively float along? It's some kind of mystical experience? I mean, isn't there obedience? Isn't there something I am supposed to be doing? We'll touch on that. You might even be a little concerned when we say that. Okay, are you discouraging obedience to God's commands? If it begins and ends by faith, are we saying then that obeying God is optional? Again, we will speak to that as we go. What I would say is the further we go into Galatians, the clearer the answer to those questions will be. No, we're not saying we're passive. No, we're not saying obedience doesn't matter. Paul deals with that the further we go. But first, he lays the foundation. And so that is where we begin as well. He lays this foundation. I'll say it again. We begin and we finish the Christian life the same way. Faith in Christ and the work of the Spirit. Now let's look first at how we begin the Christian life. I don't think we get any dispute here, but Paul will establish this in order to prove the second main idea. Look at where he tells us, verses 1 and 2, this reminder. Here's how you began the Christian life. You foolish Galatians, who has bewitched you? Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was clearly portrayed as crucified. I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Now, you've probably noticed Paul's using some strong language here, isn't he? In this paragraph, calls them foolish Galatians. In verse 1, and he asked them in verse 3, are you so foolish? We might be taken aback by Paul's language here. Make no mistake, he expresses his affection for them in other places, calls them brothers and sisters throughout the letter, calls them in chapter 4, my dear children. He says in chapter 4, this is the kind of relationship they had. If you were able, he says, you would have torn out your own eyes and given them to me. Some kind of bodily affliction with eyesight that Paul had. And the Galatians would have been willing to give them their eyes if it was possible. So these two groups of people love one another. Don't miss that. But the Galatians are playing a dangerous game. They are flirting with a gospel that would take them away from the grace of Christ, that would expose them to the curse of God. And so because he loves them, he's willing to be blunt with them. He's willing to be straightforward and to confront them in order to open their eyes to their terrible danger. In fact, maybe you've noticed as we read the paragraph, it's just a series of one question after another, almost like an interrogation. Paul's just trying to get them to think, what are you doing? And when he calls them foolish, he's not criticizing them intellectually. He's just saying, how can you fail to apply what you know? You know the gospel, Christ crucified. You began your whole life as a believer by trusting that gospel message. How then can you think you'll complete it? By works. Look at how he digs into their original experience of the gospel. Verse 1, I love Paul's language here. Who has bewitched you? If you have the NLT, it says, who has cast an evil spell on you? This is a word that's used in other Greek writings to talk literally about witches casting spells on people. And they would use the evil eye to do so. We still use that phrase, don't we, these days? You gave someone the evil eye, or my personal favorite, the stink eye. We don't mean it in terms of witchcraft and wizardry and what have you. And I don't think Paul means it quite so literally there. But he's saying you've come under an evil influence. Who brought this evil influence your way, and why did you submit to it? He says, before your very eyes, Jesus Christ is clearly portrayed as crucified. He says, look, if someone's put the evil eye on you, then you need to remember what I first laid out in front of you when I preached the gospel. I set it before you, not literally with pictures, not using Greek rhetoric, but he clearly and vividly explained to them the crucified Christ in whom they should believe. And notice especially, he draws attention to the cross. I didn't just preach Christ to you. I preached the crucified Christ. Why? Because if Christ has been crucified, then that rules out of court anything we might do in order to gain this right standing with God or keep the right standing with God. How did he end the previous chapter? If righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. You see the centrality of the cross. It rules out of bounds any human effort or achievement to stand right before God. And Paul says, that's what I first told you. Think of the way we teach our children. It's one of the first songs you teach children. Jesus loves me, this I know. Later verses talk about Jesus loves me, he who died. We tell our children it's because Jesus loves you and died for you. And we tell adults that because we need to hear it as well. Jesus loves you and died for you. What's that mean? He's done everything. There's nothing else that we would need to do in order to stand right before him other than trusting that message. So if that's the foundation, if that is the beginning of the Christian faith, then why do we think that something is going to come in later and somehow complete that? Make it official. And I think this affects how we view forgiveness, doesn't it? We might think of free forgiveness as that's what God gives you when you first believe, when you first come to understand the Christian message. So when you're a young person maybe, or if you came to faith later in Christ, when you first hear about the gospel, okay, everything's free. God forgives you. But now you know better. Now you've heard more Bible. And so you're not going to get off quite so easily if you do not obey God now. Friends, free grace, free forgiveness, you're going to be trusting that your whole life. From beginning to end, we trust the free mercy of our God. And mercy doesn't get shorter, and mercy doesn't get earned the further we go. Revelation 12 talks about the accuser of our brothers being hurled out, no longer being able to stand before God, and the saints triumphing over him through the blood of the Lamb and the word of our testimony. The condemning voice of Satan will follow you all your life, and the pardoning voice of Christ is your only hope. And don't think the condemning voice will somehow motivate you to do better. The love of the Good Shepherd is what changes us and produces obedience. Notice Paul goes on in verse 2. Here he moves into an area of discussion that maybe is a little different from how we talk. He asked them, I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Now notice there's the same contrast from chapter 2. How did you access God's grace? Works of the law, obeying the law, or believing the gospel message. The right standing comes you through faith. not through works. But notice how he changes his language a little bit. He doesn't ask them, how did you get saved? How did you get right with God? He asks them, how did you receive the Spirit? Now, we don't talk much like that, do we, when we explain how our Christian lives began. We ask people when they join our church, tell us why you're a Christian. We've never yet asked somebody, tell us about when you received the Spirit. Some people even think of receiving the Spirit as that, well, that comes later. That's after you get saved and you receive the Spirit and then you can obey, or then you have assurance, or then you do maybe even charismatic signs and wonders. But that's not how Paul talks, is it? He puts receiving the Spirit at the beginning of their Christian life. Why does he do that? I think for two reasons. One, we begin the Christian life when the Spirit of God enables us to believe, opens our eyes to our state without Christ, and enables us to believe the gospel. Ezekiel says, I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will put my Spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees. God effectively changes who we are on the inside so that we now respond to him through faith in Christ. And if you look at the full teaching of this throughout the whole Bible, it's not just, well, God will make the first move. God puts the ball in your court. No, God comes and effectively summons us to faith in Christ. That is how our Christian life begins. But there's another thing that happens there at the beginning of our Christian life. This is probably what Paul's emphasizing here. And that is that the Spirit of God comes to live inside of us. The Spirit of God actually takes up residence in us when we first believe the gospel. Romans 8, verse 9 reads, you, however, are not in the realm of the flesh, but are in the realm of the Spirit, if indeed the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, they do not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, then even though your body is subject to death because of sin, the Spirit of life, or the Spirit gives life because of righteousness. Notice really similar themes there in Romans 8. The Spirit of God lives in us. This is how we enjoy the presence of Christ. That's why we talk about Jesus living inside of us. By means of the Spirit, Christ lives within us individually, as well as being with us as a body when we meet to worship. Later in Galatians, Paul will say, because you are his sons, God sent the Spirit of his Son into our hearts, the Spirit who calls out Abba, Father. In chapter 5, we'll get there later, obviously. But we know well the passage here about walking by the Spirit, producing the fruit of the Spirit. What's the whole point? When you believe the gospel, the Spirit of God comes to live inside of you. He enables you to believe, and he takes up residence within you. And because the Spirit lives in you, you put sin to death. You bear the Spirit's fruit. You have the assurance of salvation. All of the things that God gives us in the gospel come to us by means of the Spirit. And so that's why Paul can ask him, how did you receive the Spirit? What made all this happen? Was it the works of the law, or was it believing what you heard? How did your Christian life begin? By faith in Christ and the work of the Spirit. And now Paul's going to tell us, here's the thing. That is also how you will finish your Christian life. Let's look at the rest of the passage now. This is what flies in the face of the Judaizers' gospel. They're saying, yes, faith begins, but works of the law complete. Paul will argue the exact opposite. Look at verse 3. Are you so foolish? After beginning by means of the Spirit, are you now trying to finish by means of the flesh? That word finish, it just means bring an activity to a successful finish. Think about a race. What's going to get you across the finish line in the Christian life? Is it faith in Christ? Is it the work of the Spirit within you? Or is it the power of the flesh? Is it something that you now do? That word flesh there in verses 3. Paul uses this word often in his letters to talk about that part of us that's weak, that's hostile to God, that's unable to obey him. And whenever the law comes to a person who is flesh, it only produces rebellion. Paul writes in Romans 7, when we were in the realm of the flesh, the sinful passions aroused by the law were at work in us so that we bore fruit for death. But now, by dying to what once bound us, we have been released from the law so that we serve in the new way of the Spirit and not in the old way of the written code. Notice how that ties into the gospel. The law condemns you, but the Spirit of God enables you to believe, and you lay hold of Christ, and God gives life, freedom from sin's power, freedom from our natural rebellion. We go from flesh people to spirit people, so to speak. And so Paul can ask them, if you began by the Spirit, are you going to finish by means of the flesh? If it took the Spirit of God to bring you to life, then is there anything in that old nature, in that flesh, that's going to get you across the finish line? No, of course not. By nature, we don't have the inclination to do that. By nature, we don't have the power to do that. It is only this new life given by the Spirit that pushes us across the finish line. I also think, by the way, when Paul uses the word flesh here, I think he's probably talking about these regulations that apply to the flesh. Again, circumcision, dietary laws, ceremonial practices, and what have you. Paul's saying that can't defeat the flesh. That can't defeat the urge within you that wants to respond to temptation. It can't produce obedience to the law. Only God's Spirit that lives within you, only He can produce obedience. Only He can bear the Spirit's fruit. And I think what Paul is telling us here is be careful. Beware of thinking that after beginning your life, your Christian life, by the sovereign work of God's Spirit, now it's up to you to bring it to completion. Now you need these ceremonial practices to kind of drive you home. The law is a good thing. The law is a good guide. It shows us what God loves, but it is only the Spirit that can actually give us life. We're not passive. But as Paul says in chapter 2, verse 20, we live by faith in the Son of God. This is the foundation, faith in Christ and trust in the Spirit's work. I think Paul's warning us, just don't think that there's something you can do that will somehow increase your standing with God, that will somehow assure you of His final acceptance. What's your assurance that God has promised you salvation? That He has assured you that the one who began a good work in you will bring it to completion for the day of Christ Jesus. That is where our confidence is in the promises of God. In fact, notice in verse 4, Paul seems confident that the Galatians will eventually resist the false gospel and continue by means of the Spirit. He writes in verse 4, have you experienced so much in vain, if it really was in vain? Again, I appeal to the NLT, the end of verse 4. He says, surely it was not in vain, was it? Paul seems confident the way he phrases his question. This hasn't been a vain experience for you, I trust. He's hopeful that what they've experienced has been real. It's not been a sham. Notice in verse 2, he doesn't even say, did you receive the Spirit? But how did you receive the Spirit? He's reminding them of what they've experienced. He seems confident that they will conclude. And he encourages them then that what they've experienced isn't in vain. He says here, what have you experienced? Has it been in vain? That word experience, it could also be read as suffered. Ever since the Galatians became believers, they have suffered. They might have suffered persecution from the Jews. And as we said, it might be that avoiding the persecution is what's tempting them to receive the Judaizers' gospel. But you know what Paul is telling them? You have what you need to resist suffering. More than freedom from pain. You know what you need more than freedom from pain? You need the sufficiency of the Spirit. And Paul says, you have it. He's brought you thus far. He is still working among you. He will bring you to the final day. And that is what will drive you to obedience. That's what will secure your final inheritance, the Spirit and not your own performance. So notice, last verse, Paul's summary here. So again, I ask, verse 5, does God give you his spirit and work miracles among you by the works of the law or by believing what you heard? Maybe you're looking at that word miracle there. Oh, the Spirit of God works miracles among us. Well, the Spirit of God does. But the word translated miracle could also be just deeds of power. Maybe not as technical as it might sound at first. And he's talking about the Spirit of God bringing us to life, the Spirit of God living within us. He's probably referring somewhat to the gifts of the Spirit that we read about in places like 1 Corinthians 12, that each of us as a member of the body has a gift from the Spirit that we use to serve the body. And Paul's saying, how did you get that Spirit? How did you get him in the first place? How are you enjoying him now? Is it through your cooperation? Or is it through believing the gospel message? Paul wants them to know, this is the assurance you have that you will finish your Christian life because of the work of the Spirit and your trust in the gospel message. And that foundation, friends, that's what will produce obedience. That's what will produce perseverance. When it comes time to get to the passages that deal with how we live out this life, they all rest on that foundation, that we can't do it on our own. But thankfully, we don't have to. Let's give thanks to God for his grace, for his mercy. Let's pray. Father in heaven, thank you for your love for us. And we rejoice in the new life of the Spirit. Sometimes in modern discussions of the work of the Spirit, it can seem like other people are enjoying some kind of work of the Spirit that we are missing out on. Father, we rejoice that all of us as believers have the Spirit living within. You gave us the Spirit to begin our Christian life, and we rejoice in that. He sets us free from sin's power, brings us into union with Christ, makes us to know the presence of Christ. Think of that Jesus is with us. We long sometimes to see him with our own eyes, but you promise he's with us in a way that he was not with people when he walked on earth. He's with every believer throughout the world. We have the whole Christ with us at all times. We just rejoice in that work of the Spirit. And I pray that we would rejoice and just rest more and more in the sufficiency of Christ. Lord, your gospel promises us life and forgiveness. We long to obey you. But I pray the power to do so would come from resting in you and the work of the Spirit. There's nothing we can do to secure your final acceptance. We must continually trust in the gospel. And to that end, then, we pray you'd produce the Spirit's fruit among us. Help us to put sin to death and to bear more and more of the Spirit's fruit. And we ask this in Jesus' name.